clean queens, we're down to three cleaners, we're down to three cleaners. So it's the same people doing all the work. We're trying to keep the church open, we just have to do the sanitizing until this is over. But I thought those, the nursery opened now, and the run's down, and then that's. Chicken market tickets are due to be turned in today, or at least the head count. I have to call in tomorrow, so if you don't get that head count, see if you haven't already done so. I can't count the dinners in the other side. And the only day that's gonna be nice is because it's gonna be Thursday. So we look forward to chicken market, but only Sunday, we got a lot of folks.
Good.
Thank you.
That's really good. That's really good news. Anyone else? Well, I think we're ready to worship then. Join me in the call to worship. In the wilderness, water brings life. In the word of God, the good news gives light. In the bread and the wine, the body of our Savior nourishes everyone.
Jesus, O God, and give us yourself.
Here is the water of life, the word that feeds the food of eternity. Come and praise the vine that gives all goodness. Please join me now in the opening prayer. Wondrous vine grower, you make all things new in water and word. Feed your people with love, joy, and peace. Lead us today and every day to the front of new beginnings. Teach us to love what you have commanded and to prune what does not nourish. In the name of the Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer, one God now and forever. Amen.
baptism, God claimed you and joined you to Christ as branches to a vine. Believe the promise given to you in Jesus Christ. You are forgiven. Please join me now in our prayer for illumination. Come, Holy Spirit, that through your word we may be guided into the love of God for our world. Amen.
Scripture reading this morning is from 1 John chapter 4, verses 7 through 21. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God, and everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. He who does not love does not know God, for God is love. In this, the love of God was manifested toward us, that God has sent his only begotten Son into the world, that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has seen God at any time. If we love one another, God abides in us, and his love has been perfected in us. But this we know, that we abide in him, and he in us, because he has given us of his Spirit. And we have seen and testified that the Father was sent, that the Father has sent the Son as Savior of the world. Whoever confesses that Jesus is the Son of God, God abides in him and he in God. And we have known and believed the love that God has for us. God is love, and he who abides in love abides in God, and God him. Love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, because fear involves torment. But he who fears has not been made perfect in love. We love him because he first loved us. If someone says, I love God, and hates his brother, he is a liar. For he who does not love his brother whom he has seen, how can he love God whom he has not seen? And this commandment we have from him, that he who loves God must love his brother. The gospel reading this morning is from John, chapter 15, verses 1 through 8. I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that bears fruit, he prunes, that it may bear more fruit. You are already clean because of the word which I have spoken to you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me, and I in him, bears much fruit. For without me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, he is cast out as a branch and is withered. And they gather them and throw them into the fire, and they are burned. If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, You will ask what you desire, and it shall be done for you. By this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit, so you will be my disciples. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Said full before I started, but it seems to be out. So, no, that's okay.
I'll get you that one. Yeah, take
this.
Just do what I say.
Yes, dear. Okay, I was going to suggest somebody get the other pack, but that's okay. We're ready to rock and roll. You know, I title this Irises and Daisies, but roses could have been included in this. They were favorite flowers of my mom, roses, and she loved calla lilies. My sister was fond of irises and calla lilies. So needless to say, when a special occasion comes around, my mom's no longer with us, but my sister still gets irises and calla lilies on the occasion, be it, you know, a birthday or an anniversary. It doesn't matter. Occasionally, though, it's given as a peace offering. That happens if you want forgiveness. And that works both ways for men and women. And then, of course, there's always the expression of, realize it's always an expression of love. And then again, there's Mother's Day, which is next Sunday, for those needing a reminder to purchase said flowers for the occasion. I personally have been fond of wildflowers. Buttercups, forget-me-nots, vinca, and daisies. Daisies are my favorite. And I remember so much as a kid, he loves me or she loves me, not going through the whole daisy, destroying it by pulling out each petal, and thinking that that was so magical. And that was a fond memory, I must admit. But it's in retrospect today that I know that what I was appreciating along the creeks and on the mountainsides and such was God's artwork. It was natural. Now, my parents had flower gardens and I liked them a lot. But I really loved the wildflowers where God just allowed a seed to die and a plant to bloom. John 15 opens with, "Beloved, let us love one another because love is from God." Not beloved, let us love God. Today's epistle makes a significant point about what love actually is. God wasn't playing with the daisy. God just loves us. Our human expression of love is something we direct toward an unseen being. And because God is unseen and far away, we tend to be a little offhanded about it at times. It's easy to say, "I love you," or "I love God," when it's some celestial being somewhere out there and we don't know anything much about it except for what we read. Maybe if we're fortunate enough to have money, we'll write a check for people that, you know, are less fortunate. And this signifies our love for humankind. The less fortunate are not directly in our lives, though. But you see, First John doesn't allow us the luxury of dismissing our love for humankind in any way, shape, or form. We don't love God when we act as if God doesn't exist. In our daily life, at work, in traffic, at home, or when we treat people poorly. We are willing to overlook to be seen in a better light by our supervisors? Are we transparent in our lives and ready to be accountable?
how we show love when we're accountable. Are we willing to admit that we have broken something at work or just passed the buck? Are we willing to accept our fault when we leave late for an appointment and we want to beep horns in traffic and wave fists when really that dump truck going up the hill and at 15 miles an hour fully loaded? Pelting your windshield, even though it's tarped, is good reason to start turning the air blue. Are we willing to take a few moments after a challenging day and sit in the car and breathe deep, deeply in and exhale, allowing all the tension of the day to disappear so you don't spread that anger and angst that you have from work on those you love because you're angry with the boss or a coworker. But those expressions are too often near and dear. The text says we're to love God because God is born of God. We feel love because our being was born of God and the love of God. In other words, without God, we wouldn't even know what love is. The scripture insists that those who love God must love one another, even the ones that are difficult to love. God says we must love one another. The word must is in at least the New King James Version. And then John takes it to another level. God is love. God is just that. It's entirely a different story, and it's a lot harder to love God, our Creator, with our hearts and minds and our beings. This is especially true if our expression of love for God is contingent on how we love those people in our daily life. In this 9-11, in this love God was manifest toward us that God has sent His only begotten Son into the world that we might live through Him, live through Jesus. In this love, not that we love God, but that God loves us. And He sent His Son to be the propitiation of our sins, our forgiveness for sins. Beloved, God so loved us, we ought to love one another. God sent Jesus as a sacrifice. We say it over and over and over again, but does it really hit us right in the heart as it should? Because you see, God sent His Son not only for our sake, but for the sake of the whole world. God gave Jesus in humankind form because God loved us. A person as a word of love, a sign of love. That's what Jesus was, our sign of love. God in flesh, as a human being to human beings. Jesus was perfect. And we are not. But that is our model to strive for. We are to strive to become more like Christ-like people, growing and maturing and filled with the grace of God. We might be obliged to think it's impossible, but it doesn't excuse us from making an effort. Because God says we must love one another. We must love. John Wesley speaks of grace in three forms. Prevenient grace, grace we receive while we remain unknowing, like a child. Justifying grace where we are knowledgeable, therefore are accountable. And that's where most of us live quite often. And then we're trying to move toward perfection through sanctifying grace. Today's scripture describes perfect love as not our love for God, but our love for each other. It strikes me that what we really are, if we're all loved by God and filled with God's love, we serve as a representative of our unseen God, each of us. When stated in this light, we can only begin to imagine, actually, the magnitude of our God's love for us. No one has seen God at any time. If we love one another, God abides in us. His love has been perfected in us. By this we know that we abide in him and he in us, because he has given us of his Spirit. There are a lot of people we meet that we can deem quite challenging to love. It seems an unmistakable message, though. The challenge is in the practical practice of love that we make culturally complex. Love will always be complicated for us on earth. Always. Because each situation or person can bring challenges that may baffle us for a while. Or we need to work through the ethics that are involved in each situation and the person that brings it. However, gaze at the world with the conflict that permeates all the cultures and societies and traditions, beliefs. Science is bringing us new information all the time. It's canceling facts or knowledge gleaned earlier. It doesn't mean that science was wrong, because science seeks truth and understanding. The latest equipment with improved characteristics allow us to discover new and better concepts, meeting challenges that have baffled us medically for decades. Isn't it wonderful that today we can do surgery laparoscopically instead of making large incisions that take forever to heal and create a lot of scar tissue? Thank God for science. And today our bishops have tasked us with talking about racism right in the forefront. And many remain in denial of the whole impact of racism and how it plays in our country and our world. Culturally, the belief a person who identifies as LGBTQIA can simply be killed for who they are. And then again, there are women in this world, in this country, white women, who earn 72 cents to every dollar a man makes. There's disparity. But that's for a Caucasian woman. Women of color earn 50 cents per dollar a man earns. There are many single mothers of all races out there. But rather than address the issues sometimes, it's just easier to say they're lazy, when in fact, they're working several jobs. You know, what really brings me a picture to me was back to science, of course. Was that we don't use iron lungs anymore. Iron lungs don't exist. Science is continuing to seek the truth and deal with the variants with COVID. It's been a long time. But thinking about toughing it out versus not taking the vaccine is really like not taking your blood pressure medication because your blood pressure is suddenly fine, but it's fine because you were taking the medication. Of course, you may think it is only hurting yourself, but should you suddenly have a stroke or damage your kidneys, it'll affect your whole family too. That's why when we don't vaccinate, we're affecting other people, not just ourselves. There are variants out there that will cease to be able to be aggressive if we stay vaccinated, so far science believes at this point. But the whole idea that other people are representatives of God's love, that alone is our expression of our love to God. That's how we show our love to God. When we treat other people as God's representative, because God has filled each and every one of us with love, we have no love without God's love. Love is being perfected in us, but then John didn't quit yet. John went on to say, there's no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, because fear involves torment. But he who fears has not been made perfect in love. we love him because he first loved us. If we're moving toward perfection or sanctifying grace, truthfully, we are a work in progress. And trust me, we all have fears. What we are doing as we strive in this place of justifying fear, when we are met with challenges that seem beyond our pale, that's when we tend to pray and express our love for God and express our love for each other through prayer. And it is the perfect time. Don't get me wrong. The truth is, we need to remember to pray for the little things. We must pray for the little things. I just remembered in school, it's not something very well related. I'll let it go for another time. So now, to all my fellow warriors and those who become anxious when meeting life's challenges, you are not alone. You are moving towards perfection because we aren't perfect. Jesus Christ was the only perfect being when Jesus came here, fully human and fully God. And if we feel we are to do something about a problem, sometimes we worry, but I say we pray, even for those little things. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, because fear involves torment. And I don't know about you, but to me, fear is torment. Fear is torment. Worry is torment. Fear itself is the punishment in this situation, at the very least. Trust me, when you wonder how someone drenched in problems can be so calm, and people can say they are so strong, this is true because they have found peace through prayer. They've got to a place of perfect love with God. They've got to that place. The truth is, though, sometimes we just have trouble staying in that place. That's why we continue to pray. This worry also can build our blood pressure up, damaging all sorts of things. So this is something that we should let go of. Worry, sometimes we do just simply because it makes us feel like we're doing something. Do something, pray. Pray frequently, daily. Invite the presence of God into our lives. Nobody ever trips over a mountain. We don't trip over those mountains. We've got it full of prayer. But it's those little things that we stumble over. And they too need prayer. I remember the wrath of God that we read about in the Old Testament. The fear factor and the wrath of God we see there. But if we really paid attention as we were reading the scripture, and we need to go back and reread it because we do forget, is that God made covenant with Noah and other prophets as went along, promising this love. He promised not to flood ever again. Noah, we have the rainbow sign. God has come to us as love through the death and resurrection of his son Jesus. Our faith will find most times seemingly a constant struggle with daily life, unless we seize that precept that the text offers. Love is possible because of God. Love is possible because of God, and God is love. The text forces us into this confrontation with fear that divides and separates people that we exist on the planet with. We need to love boldly because there is no love of God if there is no love for our neighbor. The word boldly was mentioned in there, meeting each day with the knowledge that God is love in prayer, and people serve, that we are with service representatives. We might find and be able to become courageous and not fear because we know that that's God's love. And God loves us as much as everyone else after all. We're not different. God loves us all. And after all, it's worth a try. Pray every day. Several times a day for your fears and for the reminder that each and every one of us represent God. We're all equal. There's no difference. no difference among us. Don't wait for the mountains. Or if we are facing an avalanche that has come down because we choose to change things and live differently, it happens in AA. We stop and the avalanche comes down. We have a mess to clean up and we need to lean into God. And we need to lean into God for love and forgiveness to bring us through because we want the love of others. And that is found in each other. I know I'm repeating the same word a lot, but it is true. We are God's representatives. And how we love each other and treat each other is very much how we show God we love God. So, love each other dearly, dearly. Don't challenge each other. Don't compete with each other. Love each other. Serve each other. Use them as a gift to you. And then again, using gifts to ask for forgiveness when appropriate never hurts. Irises and daisies, roses, all will help bring love about. Because love is really about how we treat each other. It's how we treat our families. It is our treatment of others. That is it alone. We are God's representatives.
She is dead, is oh so gone.
Are there any joys or concerns or God moments people would like to share now? Rick, good.
I would like prayers for my brother Bill, slightly older than I am. He's diabetic, and he went to the hospital. His foot is extremely infected, and his body is riddled with toxins. And it's very poignant to my family because my father, our father, ended up double amputee. So I would really like prayers for my brother Gil.
Absolutely. Diane.
My glory is seeing some guests here today. Thanks for joining us. I'd like to ask for continued prayers for Ron for his back. He's more than likely dependent on surgery. And prayers for my sister as she embarks the journey with breast cancer. Finding out maybe that things aren't as bad as we just don't know, but we go to the doctor this week. So prayers for Daddy.
Of course.
And we do appreciate all the support we've been given.
I also, Beverly.
Prayers for Carol Kennedy.
Yes.
She needs some health issues.
Yeah. Serious health issues, we think. Hard to know. But we trust in God. God casts out fear, right? Pray, pray. I seriously.
I'd like to thank you all for the prayer that you've been doing for Jody. She's slowly but surely getting better. She is getting discouraged because it's taking so long. It's been almost a month now. Mm-hmm. And it's taking a toll on her. They just aren't doing much to help her. They don't know what really to do. So we got to keep her praying to God that he continues to heal her and make her better. She's going back to work Monday, tomorrow, for the first time. Before she goes back to work, she's having some minor surgery done in the morning. So please keep her in your prayers tomorrow, along with Debbie. And that I know things are going to work out fine. And I do want to thank God. He's gotten me through this and her through this, and we're going to continue to get through this. And no matter how hard Satan should fight against you, because you believe the Lord, the creator of the universe, that our God is our Father. No matter how much attacking he does, he can't win. We will win because Jesus has already won it for us.
That's right. The word of God, the King was God. And in the end, it shows that it overcame darkness of all sorts. Satan is the darkness. Anyone else? I'm lifting my niece, Allie, and also Andrea. And I think we can go to go right to prayer now. Let's pray. Lord God, we've lifted names to you today of people who need prayer. Not only healing, but eases of fear, because we know that your love casts out all fear, and it's your love that heals. When we pray to you for the power of the Holy Spirit to work for us, we are praying for your love to work for all of us. That is your power. Your power is love. May love permeate all of us today, all of us present, all of those in our hearts and minds. And may those that are suffering feel comfort and healing. May it be rapid recovery for those. And may all this happen according to your holy word, according to your word, not ours. Prayers of intercession. Oh God, we give you thanks for your Holy Spirit, whose work at creation continues in us through Christ Jesus. You have shown your love for this earth you made. We pray that all the world may know your power and goodness. God, who makes us one.
You are our prayer.
Word of life. reveal the wonder of your world to all people. Show us anew what lives around us, over us, beneath us, within us. Enliven the church with your spirit that we may honor your earth with responsible care. God, who makes us one. Almighty God, uphold our sisters and brothers who endure disasters caused by weather, war, famine, sickness, or greed. Strengthen those who are in peril, especially people of India and in Israel. You are our refuge and strength, a very present help in our time of trouble. God, who makes us one. Giver of all good things, bring trust and sympathy to the nations of the world. Let peacemakers reign whenever there is conflict. Give wisdom to leaders and hope to the poor. God, who makes us one. Good healer, we pray for all who need comfort. Comfort to those who mourn. Uphold those who are sick or are holding vigil or are waiting words of hope, especially those we've named aloud before or silently. God, who makes us one. Trusting in your mercy, we commend you to you all those we have named and those whose needs are known only to you, in the name of your Son, Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. May we say a prayer of thanks for and dedication for the offerings that we receive every week, though we are not passing the plate. We get the doxology first, don't we? I'm sorry. God is love. Technical difficulties today. Before our prayers of dedication, we usually do the doxology. Well, that is.
Hold on.
We gotta hire an imprinter.
probably announce this at the beginning of the service, but next Sunday, Pastor Kate will be on vacation.
Oh, yeah.
And we do have a lay speaker from within the conference. Her name is Joan. I don't know.
Robinson.
Joan Robinson.
Drop the N, Robinson.
Okay. Joan. My good friend Joan, but I don't even know her yet. But anyway, we will have a lay speaker next week, and so we certainly hope that Pastor Kate has a great week off and
get to hug my
dad. See y'all back here.
Good for you.
On Mother's Day. Thanks.
Yes, Mother's Day. And don't forget the flowers for Mother's Day. They mean love. As Jesus entered into human life, his life is still alive in you. The blessing of Almighty God be upon you today and always. Go out with joy that you've been fed and healed, securely abiding as branches of the true vine. Go and tell the story of faith. This is the word to you by the one who never lets you go. Seek out those who abound with sacred questions and be ready to answer a mystery of love. Amen.